excited myself about today. Where was y'all at last Sunday? I don't remember seeing many of you. Maybe because we didn't have church. But thank the Lord and praise the Lord that He spared us through that storm. Amen. Amen. We need to be praying for the families, though, that was not spared. I think about 20 some odd, I think, the last time I saw was loss of loved ones and a lot of damage, a lot of homes destroyed and everything. So just praise the Lord that we come through it, Lord, safe and sound. We just thank you, Lord, and praise you, and we thank you so much. In your bulletin, we have the Sanctity of Life prayer chain today from 2:30 to 3:30 at Burger King, as we usually do for our county. Also tonight, we'll have a sing tonight. I'm looking forward to that. A lot of great songs tonight. And also, we will have some food for refreshments afterwards. And we're certainly glad to Mr. Chris, Brother Chris, and his wife and his family. He is a manager at Piggly Wiggly, and he has donated 5 gallons of oysters for us to have oyster stew tonight. And that's $80 or $90 a gallon, and we appreciate that so much. And if you want to thank him for it, shop at Piggly Wiggly. And I know he'd appreciate that very much. Hey, we appreciate that, Brother Chris. Hey. We're going to have some oyster stew, and I think we're going to have some raw oysters. People like raw oysters. Now, the raw oysters will be for old people who don't have teeth. But anyway, we're going to have some refreshments, and we appreciate it so much tonight. We're looking forward to praise the Lord in song service tonight. On a little sadder note, we know that Kenny, I believe, is going through a surgery this Wednesday, and we're going to be praying for him. And Miss Laquita, the 17th of February for gallbladder surgery. Miss Sue, the 6th, is that correct? I ain't getting into that, Robert. Oh, anyway, a lot of people are sick and have a lot of procedure to go through, so we pray for each and every one of them. And also, Brother Marshall's Uncle Lester is in very critical condition in Savannah, Georgia, so we need to be praying for him. So there's a lot of people sick and really, really sick. So be praying for ones we have on our prayer list, Miss Sandra and others that we have on our prayer list. But we just want to thank you today in the name of Jesus Christ, Brother Orville. And also Brother Orville's back's out, so be praying for him.
What a day that will be.
Oh. precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a Lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men.
Lost our way. Oh, we've hopelessly lost
Amen. Thank you for all those songs. Do you have a home to go to? Because there will be a time of calling. If you're not saved, you need to make it sure today. You'll have an opportunity when the Lord calls, because He will call on each and every one of us. Ready or not, here I come, saith the Lord. I hope that you're ready. You can be. I hope that you'll be ready today. Again, thank you, and I appreciate good singing and good gospel singing. Daniel chapter 1, I'll be reading a few verses from Daniel chapter 1. Looking around our country and our world today, would you say it is really in a mess? We are living in very dangerous time, and turmoil is all around us. And for the average Christian, cannot get a grasp and understand exactly what is happening in our culture that we're living in today. But the Bible tells us that He wants us to know. So we should know what's happening in our culture today. And the title of it is Judeo-Christian Culture. Judeo-Christian Culture. To understand this, we need to understand what Judeo means. Jews, Jewish likes, Jewish values. And most of us from my age and on up in a generation maybe younger than me was raised in a Judeo-Christian culture. I was raised, and I'll explain what that is in just a moment. But we have passed in my lifetime from a Judeo-Christian culture to a post-Judeo-Christian culture. But now we are living in an anti-Judeo-Christian culture. Anti means against, in the place of. We're living that day right now, and a lot of us do not understand, and it's hard to grasp exactly what's happening in our country, in our culture, because the Judeo-Christian culture is the only culture that I knew. All my life, I was raised in that to the last 50 or 60 years, and it comes to be a post-Judeo-Christian culture. To understand what's really going on around us, things are not like they was whenever I was a child and a young person growing up. How about you? And what has changed and what happened? Well, Daniel gives us, the first six chapters, Daniel gives us the application of what we need to know and understand today about our culture. What's going on in our culture? The first six chapters of Daniel give us the application for our time and illustration for our time. And the last six chapters of Daniel deal strictly with prophecy and the book of Revelations. But the first six tells us and gives an insight that we should know and understand what's really happening on us, especially our young people we're bringing into this world, our kids and our grandkids, and mothers and fathers. If you understand what's happening, you would not miss a service from this church or any church that you're a member of. Because the critical times for your children is at hand. Because they are living and already in an anti-Judeo-Christian culture. And the failures of mothers and fathers not understanding this and not seeing it where it ought to be is going to cause a failure to their kids, their grandkids, and on. Because like it or not, we are living in an anti-Judeo-Christian culture today. Daniel chapter 1, verse 1. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, King Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, unto Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hands, with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar. That's another name there for Baghdad. So the house of his gods, and he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his gods. Now the king spoke unto Azazel, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seed and of the princes, children whom was no blemish, but well favored and skillful in all wisdom and cunning and knowledge and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the learnings and the tongue of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat and of wine which he drunk, so nourished them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you for this privilege this day. We thank you for this great word of God, that we may see our generation and each generation exactly how you see it, Father, in your word. That, Lord, that we have no excuse for not understanding what's happening around us, what has already happened in our culture and our country, and we live today. And to help us and to mothers and fathers and the family members to get a good grasp, if not, they're going to stand before a foreign king. And we just pray, God, that we may help. Lord, we might be the people that you called us to be, and see the failures of the nation Israel, that we won't fall by the same way that they fell. So, Father, you want to give us this day our daily bread, and we thank you for it in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, and amen. Now, Daniel is like us today. He grew up in a crisis today, and it was a crash. And we're headed for a crash in our country, whether you understand it or not. Economy crash is coming to our country. We keep spending more money than what we're taking in. We're already in a moral crisis in our country, and we're into a spiritual crisis in our country right now. But Daniel grew up in a Judeo culture. The Jews, the Old Testament, the Ten Commandments. United States, the day we grew up in that at my age. Traditional family values and moral compass was the word of God in my time, the area that I grew up in. But now we're challenged more each day as I live this life, more each day. At my age, and also maybe a few people younger than us, we, all of us, have been blessed by the Judeo-Christian culture was already established before I was born. Every one of us has this great blessing and these values that surround us each day. The past and the present, but look out into the future. For 200 years or so that our country has been blessed by these Judeo-Christian ethics, that we have the Word of God. Of my past, the Judeo-Christian ethics, the Bible. If you don't know what I'm talking about, if any of you can remember, when you went to school, the Bible was on the teacher's desk. I remember the teacher reading us Bible stories in our classroom. The Ten Commandments was on the walls. Prayer was over the intercom system or from class to class. Y'all remember those days? If you remember those days, you was brought up in the Judeo-Christian culture. That's the day that you was brought up in. We was brought up in this community that we're living in, here in Pierce County and all of Georgia in this country. We was brought up in this Judeo-Christian culture. Now, there was a lot of people was not saved, but they respected the Word of God. I was brought up in a home. My dad did not go to church. My dad was a lost person. He did not go to church. A lot of people in this community was lost people. They did not go to church. They had more respect for the things of God.
than saved people do today. Why? Judeo-Christian culture they was raised in across this country, there was no working on Sunday. Never saw anybody out in the field when I was coming up, any type of work. There was no fishing, no hunting. The recreation time was at a very minimum. There was a blue law in Georgia. If you don't know what the blue law was, that was the stores did not open on Sunday. You could go to Waycross and very few stores was open on Sunday in Waycross if you got a chance to go to Waycross. Why? Judeo-Christian culture. That's the reason that we grew up and had the blessing in our country so many years ago. And we lived through that. But from 1960, about it, when prayer was robbed and stole out of our schools. There would be no Bible in schools. The Ten Commandments was off the walls. We begin to experience in this country a post-Judeo-Christian culture. For the last 50 or 60 years, this has been going on. And yet us Christians can't understand what's happening. Just a few years. But now today, the day that we are living, it is past. Now we are living in an anti, that means against, instead of God, Judeo-Christian culture in the United States today. That's the reason we have the problem that we're having and we don't understand what's really happening. Most Christians are still living and don't understand, are still living in this world that we're living in, and we don't understand that we've moved out of Judeo-Christian culture and their ethics. This is the only world that we know. The Judeo-Christian culture is the only world that I know. The anti-Christian culture does not share our values. They do not share our values. And our biblical and Bible truth is taught throughout the Word of God. The anti-Christian culture, we have been called on in every generation to reach the people that's lost, but we're living in this anti-Judeo-Christian culture. We don't know how to understand how to reach people in this culture. We point our finger in accusation at the social ills of our country, and rightly so. We point our fingers at the court system of our country, and rightly so. At the government, and rightly so. At our education system, and rightly so. How can we change this anti-Judeo-Christian culture in which we live? Well, Daniel, in the Word of God, gives us the application and the illustration to enable us and to your children and to your grandchildren. Mothers and fathers, if you don't understand this, you're bringing a great fall to your children. And that's what's happening to the younger generation the day that you and I are living in the youth today. Mothers and fathers do not understand that we're living in the anti-Judeo-Christian culture today that is against God, and very few mothers and fathers sees this and cares enough about it to have their children where Daniel says they ought to be in the Word of God, at the house of God, learning about the things of God, that they be able to stand against the anti-Judeo-Christian culture that they're living in each day, and it's going to get worse. Now, churches have tried and attempted to reach this anti-Judeo culture by how? One way, by compromise. Go along and get along. Don't hurt anybody's feelings. Don't hurt anybody's feelings. They have also tried to condone the culture. Accept anything. The alternate lifestyle is accepted into the churches a lot of time. The same-sex marriage is accepted in. Condone this anti-Judeo-Christian culture to the day. Why? Why was not this happening back when you was a child and I was a child in this country we're living in? Simply because Judeo Christian culture is no longer here today and was then. Daniel confronts and engages it and gives it to us so we may understand. What's happening in his day is the same thing that's happening in our day today. Daniel and his three Hebrew friends, it calls them children, and I got this on the board, but that's a word that's not called a baby in the Hebrew, but it's called a young person, a teenager probably. Where was this? Well, the history tells us there was 12 tribes of the nation of Israel. They had a civil war, most like our civil war we had in this country. There was a north and there was a south in this civil war. 10 of the tribes went with the northern kingdom. 2 tribes, Judah and Benjamin, went with a southern tribe, which was called Judah. In 722 B.C., the Assyrian captivity carried the northern tribe into their captivity. The southern Judah captivity lasted until 605, and Babylon come in to Judah and Jerusalem, and we know they captured them into captivity and carried them away into Baghdad, Iraq now. Who? Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. He was the world power at that time. No other power in the world was as strong as the power of Babylon. When was this? Daniel says in verse 1 that I just read, the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah. Well, what was this? Daniel 2 says that God gave Nebuchadnezzar the power to go in and bring those into captivity. God done that. Nebuchadnezzar was nothing but a remote control in the hands of Almighty God, and all rulers is today. And that gives me great, great hope to know that God is still in the control. Babylon in captivity was a judgment of God on the Jewish people. The Jewish people. What did they want? They would not heed to the word of God. They would not hear the word of God. They would not do the word of God. Moses, on the very eve going into the land of Canaan, gave that great 10 commandments again and stated them, when you go into this land that you never lived before, and he gave them the 10 commandments, and he gave them to the fathers, for your household, and to see that your children hears these commandments and do these commandments. And the order of God's order in his Bible is to the man, to the home, to the house, and the daddy, you're the home, and you're the house, the head of the house in the home. They would not do this. So after a few years not doing this, they was carried away into captivity several years. And here's what they said in Psalms 137:1, by the river of Babylon, there we sat down, yeah, we wept. And I'll tell you what, there's going to be some weeping in America. There's going to be some weeping for mothers and fathers that resist the word of God and deny the word of God and will not do the word of God as God said for your children to be at the house of God when they should be. And it says, when we remembered Zion, they remembered when they should have been there and they wasn't doing what God called them to do. We hang our harps upon the wilderness in the midst thereof. For there they that carried us away captive required us a song. That they wasted us required us myrrh, saying, sing us one of those songs of Zion. And then they said, how shall we sing the Lord's song in a strange land? I'm telling you what, we're living in a strange land. We're no longer living in a Judeo-Christian culture world that you and I was brought up in, most of us today. Why? Hebrews 12:6 says, for whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. 1 Corinthians 10:6 says, now these things were because of an example to the intent we should not lust after the evil things as they lusted and fell. The United States, I said, is headed already into a crash. We in a moral crash today that we're living in right now. We're going to head into an economical crash if we keep going in the direction we're going in, and we're already in a spiritual crash right now. David gave us the prescriptions to prevent this crash and to change our country and our world that you and I are living in today. I tell you now, there's a captivities. But now you see these captivities today and understand this captivity and understand what happened in Daniel chapter 1 and 2 again, and we've already read. They defile that land. They was carried away hundreds of miles into captivity in the land of Babylon. I don't know about you. Have you ever been off your kids coming up in school? Did you ever have to go to a strange school? Your mom and daddy ever moved and you had to go to a strange school? Well, my dad, he followed a carpenter business, and we moved back into to Miami several times and different grades. Whenever I'd go back to Miami, I'd go to a school I didn't know nobody in the world in that school. And that's a terrible, terrible feeling, I'm going to tell you, if you ever went to a school and you didn't know nobody. Well, Daniel and his friends went to a place that they didn't know nobody, into a very, very strange land. I want to tell you, there were three kings mentioned in the verse of Scripture that I read. Jehoiakim, king of Judah, of the southern tribe. He was named depravity because he was a godless king. Although he was over God's people, he was a godless king over God's people. No reverence for God, no reverence for the things of God. Be like today, it's saying people are Christians, saying people, you know, that they come to church. This man here was a godless king, no reverence for God today. They had two sins that caused him to carry away into captivity. Two great sins: disobedient to the word of God and departure from the word of God. Now, that's one of the sins today that we are going into captivity because of this same thing. Why? Disobeying the word of God. That's happening in our culture today. That is happening in the Christian community today. Disobeying the word of God. Christian today, people cannot disobey the word of God and get by with it. It will catch you one day. It will catch you one day. I was reading a rat that was gnawing on a steel file, and the more he gnawed on it, after a while there was blood on the file. Whose blood was it? Wasn't the file. It was a rat's blood. I want to tell you, there's mothers and fathers right now that's chewing on the file against God's word. And it's not going to be God's word, it's going to be you and me or whoever will not obey the word of God. Our social today is very evident. Disobey the word of God. Israel was in the land of Canaan. God gave them a lot of laws and rules. God says, let the land rest. You farm it 6 years. But that seventh year, you let the land lay out. You don't farm it. That's that seventh year. They disregarded God's word. 490 years they disregarded God's word about the land. Out of those 490 years, it meant there was 70 years of disobeying. The United States, you can't disregard God's word. Now, I don't know what year it was. Whenever it came legally all right, the Supreme Court, to kill unborn babies. Been several years. They got by 490 years. We've been getting by in our country. But I can assure you one thing, we won't keep getting by. There will come a time and God draw the line of the nation Israel, and he'll draw a line on this nation. I hope this thing is turned around. Because if he don't, if we don't, and you see what happened to all these women with all those great multitudes of people shaking their fist at God, we want to kill our babies, we want to kill our babies, we want to kill. That's what they were saying. I don't care what you say, God. A baby is not a baby in the mother's womb. Supreme Court judges says it's a non-human being. God will not let us keep going. For 70 years, they was carried away into captivity because of the sin. They would not listen to God. Jehoiakim had no reverence for God or the word of God. And I tell you, just like our ex-president, he's been an ex-president ever since he's been president because I axed him out 8 years ago. He's against God for killing unborn babies. I'm against him because he's against God. But you see, this king had no regard for the word of God as a lot of our kings. They brought Jehoiakim the Bible. He took his penknife, read it in the Bible, took his penknife and cut up the Bible and threw it in the fire. Now, the second reason they was carried away because of sin of idolatry. Israel crossed over into Canaan land and God says, have no other gods before you. We see they was carried away into Shinar, the land of Babylon. This is where the Tower of Babel was. The foundation of idolatry, the very fountainhead of idolatry for 70 years. You know what God said to that nation, Israel? They wanted to serve other gods. They wanted to serve idolatry. They wanted to serve all type of God. He said, okay, you want to listen to the people around you? You don't want to listen to my word? You don't want to listen to me? You want to serve other God? I will give you what you want. And he did. For 70 years, when they come out of captivity, they never again, even to this day, worship idols. United States, you see these marches, what they want? I tell you, God might give us what we demand and what we want. Woe, woe, woe to us if he does. The nation Israel only worshiped Jehovah, Yahweh God. They stayed in the captivity. Do you remember Nehemiah? When Nehemiah turned back, went back to the homeland, that was after 70 years that God said, you'll stay in captivity for 70 years. And Nehemiah turned back. And that's when he rebuilt the walls of Jerusalem. Now, second king, Nebuchadnezzar. Now, he was a very powerful and a brilliant military and a strategist man, but he was a very, very cruel, cruel, cruel person. But you see, there was a third God that I read. And this third God is Jehovah, God's sovereignty of God. In the book of Daniel, it says three times, the Most High rules in the affairs of man. God puts men on the throne. God takes men off the throne. God is in control of human affairs. Thank you, Lord. I got a little discouraged of this past 8 years of seeing anti-Christian fail so much or be so strong in this culture we live in. But God says, hey, I'm in control. I'd like for us to look a little bit now at the children. This is where it comes very, very important, and I know I won't have time to finish this. But the children. The children, Daniel 1, 3, and 4, as I've already read, suffer the most anti-Christian culture we live in. They suffer the most. People my age, we've done had our good stay. We've done had our good living. But the young people that's here today and the young ones that's coming along, if we as Christians don't understand mothers and fathers and grandparents, what's going on, they're going to be the ones that suffer. Your kids. If you don't see the importance of what God is telling you to do in the Word of God, they're the ones that's going to suffer. Because they're going to be in a strange land like Daniel and his three Hebrew children was. to suffer because of the sins of the mothers and the fathers. They was teenagers. Now, you look at their nobility. They was the cream of the crop, the finest of the young people. Today, who is the cream of the crop and the finest of the young people? Christians, boys and girls that support the house of God when they should? That's the very cream of the crop, and that's the one that the devil wants to be carried away. Their ability, there was no blemish. You read verse 4. The church Christians that has a future, the one that devil wants our young people. He's already got the other young people that have no ability to come and worship God. Mothers and fathers don't care, won't bring them. He wants the ones that's here. He wants the ones that comes on Wednesday night. He wants the ones in Sunday school. He wants the ones that prays. He wants the ones that witness. He wants the young people. They are the cream of the crop. They had these three young people plus Daniel selected for special training in the king of Nebuchadnezzar. They were special people. The king wanted to change their world. The devil was after them. He's after the youth across this country. But here is the crisis and the crash that's going to come. The crisis. And every child, is going to face these four crises in their life. These four crises. If you don't care, God says it's here for you. And here they are. Babylon is set out to change the young people so they could spend the rest of their time serving in the service in Babylon. That is exactly what Satan has set out to do to the young people, to change their mind from Judeo-Christian culture to anti-Judeo-Christian culture, to change their mind. What we was brought up in, well, they had the Bible at the school desk, prayer in school, and the Ten Commandments and everything because of God. The ACLU, the devil's majority there at ACLU, had done everything they can to get Bibles out of the schools. In fact, the schools will be sued a lot of time because of the Bible being in the school. Why is that? Because they want to change their mind and want to kill the authority to start off in our school system today. Everything that you see is antichrist across this land to change our young people's mind. The crisis now of their authority, not the Word of God anymore. Young people are going to face this. And it's up to mothers and fathers to help them and to train them, as God said they ought to bring them to the house of God. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, that you present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service, and be not conformed to this world, but be you transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and the accepted perfect will of God. Now, you're going to be transformed, young people. Listen, they're going to be transformed to this anti-world that we're living in, or are they going to be conformed to the Word of God? As I said, the marching for these killing babies. Daniel and three friends, they was going to get a three-year scholarship. It's what this amounts to. Room and board at the king's table. What for? To indoctrinate them and give them a program of brainwashing. Brainwashing. Today, brainwashing of our young people today and their programs they're in today. Brainwashing them into humanist, denying the deity of God. Secular humanist, man without God. The values of our self-determination. No absolute truth from the Word of God. No distinction between man and woman. Brainwashing them. That's happening the very day that we're living in. To cloud up the area between man and woman. Mothers and fathers, I tell you, if I had a little boy, it come time to get his haircut, I give him a haircut. A man's haircut. And he wouldn't put no earrings in his ears either. All this is clouding up the issue between man and woman. The devil's having a good time repeating, trying to get them into the land of Babylon. You need to be here because the devil's after your mind, your heart, and your will. You know what? We had over 40 adults here Wednesday night. I don't know how many teenagers were over learning the Word of God, but Wednesday night we had over 40 adults here. Thank you. Be here next Wednesday night. But the devil is the original brainwasher to get your brain, to get you the love of Christ out of your heart with the love of sin instead of the Word of God's truth. Now the devil, what he's doing to our younger generation every day, he's pounding. In our school system, he's pounding. You come from a monkey. It's all right to have two mamas, two daddies. The television, the sitcoms, Ellen the Degenerate. You was born that way. You couldn't help it. They can't help it. They're born that way. Pounding. The internet, the computers, the books, the magazine, brainwashing. They are being brainwashed anti-Judeo Christian culture. I wonder how many students in Pierce County High School, if they was asked about homosexuality, lesbian homosexuality, can they help it, or were they was born that way? I wonder what percentage would say they was born that way. They can't help it because everything has been pounding. Everything, everywhere, everything is pounding. The day that we're living in. The authority crisis. They may teach the learning of the tongue of the Chaldeans, the enrolled in the curriculum of the godless culture. Whenever our young people go off to these universities and these colleges, most of them are liberal teachers, professors, against the Word of God in most colleges today. Thank God for Christian teachers in Pierce County and around our country. Thank God for Christian teachers. But you got your hands full, I can tell you that. Very few in our colleges and our universities today. The theory of humanism, a public school system across our country. Then they're going to have an authority crisis. They're going to come up with this. They're going to come up with whose authority. It's either your authority or it's the Word of God authority. Whose authority is this? And then you know the moral crisis. 3-year scholarship in Babylon. Why? An opportunity to cultivate an appetite for Babylon. Change their appetite. Did you know that's exactly what this anti-Judeo-Christian culture is doing to your kids right now, mothers and fathers? To change their appetite from the love of God to the love of the things of this world. Do your kids, your teenage kids, do they get up on Sunday morning and say, "Oh, Mom and Daddy, I can't wait to go out and worship the Lord at church. Can't wait to get to Sunday school. Can't wait to get to win." Do they? They're being pounded on. They need things of this world instead of things of God. What's important now? Church worship? Serving Jesus Christ? What is important to you? The appetite for gold instead of God. Material instead of the spiritual. The temporary instead of the eternal. Pounding brainwashing through television, the media, the music, books, and on, the pleasures. Daniel chapter 5. And the king appointed them daily provisions of the king's meat and the wine which he drank, so nourished them 3 years that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. They might stand before the king. Problem? Wrong king. The king of sin, the king of pleasure, the king of sports, the king of pride, king of greed. Young people, make up your mind. You're going to stand before a king to understand which king are you going to stand before. The misery of our young people is the failure of the parents. You see, babies love Jesus Christ, as I told you Wednesday night. Babies love Jesus Christ. God put it in their heart to love God. As I explained this Wednesday night, Lily Grace, Joy showed me about when she kept the kids on the nursery. Lily Grace was singing, Jesus loved me, this I know. As I told her Wednesday night, that love is natural in a small child. But listen, parents, if that love is not cultivated, it is not growing, the devil will steal that out of the heart and replace this with the love of sin and material things in this world. They used to be, I call them old granny women. They used to have quiltings. Some of y'all don't have no idea why that is, quiltings. My grandmother used to have a quilt rack hanging down from the ceiling in one of the bedrooms. Some ladies, they'd come around, they'd have a quilting once in a while. Well, what they would do was they'd bring their squares. They'd bring their squares. Different household, different ladies would bring their squares. And they'd all put them together and get there, and they'd probably gossip. And anyway, they'd get there and they'd talk, and they would put them squares together, and they'd make a quilt for the warmth to cover up someone in that household. They'd all get together and bring their squares. For a warmth, they'd bring that square and share it for the warmth of others. You know, that's exactly what it is when this church meets. You should bring your square to sew the fabric of conviction about you, of your children and the people here in this day, that they may be able to have the warmth of the Word of God. If I could hold up a big old quilt right now, tonight, there'd be squares missing all over that quilt. There'd be squares missing. You know why? Because someone have not brought their square to share with someone else that they might be able to be warmed by the Word of God. Absent. Judeo-Christian culture. They brought their squares. Spiritual crisis. The spiritual crisis reminded me back of Moses. You know Moses? Pharaoh's daughter, you know, found him, had to get rid of him. You know, put him there in the Nile River. Moses' mother put him out there, and Pharaoh's daughter found him, had to have a nurse to wean him, went and got Moses' mother, didn't even know it, and she says, all right, you take this child away, and it comes a certain time, I'll come back and get him. She took her own child till he got time for weaning. Pharaoh's daughter come back to get him. Moses' mother said, and I wish a lot of mothers could say what Moses' mother said, but they will not, because they will not care and do not understand that it's not important to the house of God. But she says, Moses, don't forget who you are and whom you are. I wish mothers and fathers could tell their children that. Don't forget, because they're going out into a Nile-infested world, anti-Judeo Christian culture. And you better be able to tell them, don't forget who you are and what you are. Identify crisis. Well, we won't have time to get into those other verses, but they changed the name of every one of Daniel and those three Hebrew children. They changed their name. Every one of their names, Daniel and all the rest of them, had a part of Jehovah God's name. But they changed their name, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, to names of the Babylonian gods, because they want all identity erased. Same thing that they're doing today, the race away, to remove them of all knowledge of the real God. And that is exactly what's happening in our culture today. Erase all ideas of who you are, your identity of who you might be. Whenever children leave, they're going out, mothers and fathers, you cannot keep them with you. They're going. You can't go with them. But I tell you what, you can give them that fabric, everything they need. They have to be able to sew their own convictions. You cannot sew it for them. But I tell you what, a lot of teenage kids don't have any fabric to start with. Mother and the father could care less about their commitment, much less their children. So they have no material to sow their own convictions in the anti-Judeo Christian culture, which they will grow up in. It's up to mothers and fathers today. Well, what can I do? You can start today of making sure that you care enough to be committed to the Word of God and the things of God for your children and your great-grandchildren and on and to the people around you. It's all up to you. God is not going to force nobody. He told the nation of Israel exactly what to do. They did not do it. They did not heed. They disobeyed the Word of God, and they thought they was getting by. But I'll tell you what, they didn't get by. And you and I will not get by, and our country will not get by disobeying the Word of God very much longer. It will come. Now today, if you're not saved, you need to be saved. The first thing you can do to your family and around your family is make sure that you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You know the day's the day of salvation. You need to come forward and accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you've already done that, you need to make it public. How do you do that? Just by coming forward and say, I've already accepted Jesus Christ, and I'm not ashamed of him. He's not ashamed of me, and I'm not ashamed of him. I want to tell everybody I love Jesus Christ, and I've asked him in my heart. I want to be a member of this church. I want to go through baptism. I want to show the world the death, burial, and resurrection, what's already happened in my life. You need to come today. You need to come for church membership if God has spoken to your heart this day. Whatever it is, because you're living and you're bringing up your children in an anti-Judeo-Christian culture, it's already passed. The Judeo-Christian culture is gone. We will never see it again what we have saw whenever I was a child, whenever I was growing up. I don't believe it'll ever be back. But old Daniel, it didn't come back in his day. But he showed us the ingredients that we must have to go through this, and he gives us everything that we need. The application, by the Word of God, I'm going to tell you, your children, my children, people around us, our community, our nation, can do just like old Daniel did as we keep on in the book of Daniel to understand exactly what we need in the time that you and I are living in today. God bless you and thank you as we come with a song of invitation. I hope that God has spoken to your heart in a very special way. In fact, I wish everybody in the world could understand what Daniel had to say in his first few verses to the children around us today. It is so important what we're doing in the Word of God. You better be serious. But I'll tell you one that is serious, and that is the devil. That is the devil. He wants your mind, he wants your heart, and he wants your will. He's after that, brainwashing your children. None of us is immune from it. We're all exposed to it. But in the book of Ephesians, it tells us to put on the whole armor of God. I'll be on that Wednesday night. In fact, I've been on verses 10 and 11 for a whole month on Wednesday night. And there's a lot more needs to come from the Word of God. God bless you. Would you stand and sing this beautiful, beautiful song? Jesus, keep me near the cross. That's where we need to stand. That's where we need to stay. That's where we need to kneel, at the foot of the cross. As we sing in this song, God has spoke to your heart. You need to step out. Don't wait on anyone else. And just do business with the Lord. Whatever He's called on you to do.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There's a precious mountain free to all a healing stream flowed from Calvary.
Are you saved today? Are you saved today?
In the cross.
How about your family?
In the cross.
Are they concerned about worship and serving Jesus Christ? Is their number one thing on their heart? Do they have an appetite for the things of God? Or do they have an appetite for the things of this world? How about your grandchildren, mothers and fathers? Can they look back at the grandparents and they say one thing? Well, I know my grandfather and my grandmother. I know they loved the Lord because they was at the house of God every time they could be there. The one thing I remember about my grandmother, that's what they called no hard-shell churches. Primitive Baptist. She was a member. She was there. Great respect for those old churches. They believed in it because they let the world know. They believe in worship and serving Jesus Christ. How about you? Do you let the world know that you are interested in the things of God? And to your kids, whenever you're gone, grandparents from this world, it won't be much longer for some of us are gone. Well, your kids and your grandkids, they understand. Well, I can say one thing about mother and father. They loved Jesus Christ. They supported their church, and they was there when the doors was open because they want to do something for the Lord and God's people. They'll remember. They'll remember. You know, you can't fool your kids. They know mother and father if you're concerned enough. They know. They know where you stand with Jesus Christ. God bless us, and God help us not to go down the same road that the nation of Israel went down, because we're already living in this anti-Judeo-Christian culture this day. God bless you and thank you this day.